students, so once again welcome to my class. Yesterday I have already talked about different names for India, and then you learn about how this Indian name came into being. So we have to understand first of all that how this Indian name came into first of all. So yesterday I have talked about the few points with regard to the this particular chapters, and you know this first chapters in fact is speaking about the question asking. You know, in order to understand the history, you need to know the question how you can ask, especially when any of the area where any of the area suppose some kind of incident happened. So in order to make this a particular incident to know people, we need to ask the questions. So especially we will ask where did it happen, or what where happened, when it happened, and how it happened. So these are the few questions that is actually very important to know the history. And you know, to know the history, of course the sources also very important. For example, without the sources we can't really give the proper clue and evidence about the history. So therefore I have already talked about in yesterday's video about the extension of the period that actually you remember. So our usually the medieval period actually begins from the 8th century onwards, and it ends with the 18th century. So this is the extension of the period that actually have happened. And during this period of time, you know, different invaders, different group of people came to India, and then how this India actually came into contact with the other countries. And India within this time period, in which are the areas actually developed. So those are also we have discussed in yesterday's video. So now we have also learned about the how to say especially the different groups of people, especially our Indian rulers, especially the group from the Palas, Pratiharas, then Cholas, and Rajputs. These are the few original that we find from the India where existed, and their life period actually known as the early medieval period. And when we talk about the late or the later medieval period, there we will talk about the the late medieval period. When we talk about that, is actually we talk about the arrival of the Sultanate period and also the Mughal period. So this is the late medieval period, and after the declination of the Mughal period, you know, the modern period begins. That is actually arrival of the British. So that is how we will be talking about in class 8. So now you understood about how this extension have been taken place. Now when we talk about the our Indian history, so our Indian history, and especially when we talk about the context of our India, it means India, that is the Indian English term, but we have the one Indian term that is called Bharat. And this Bharat, the term Bharat in fact is originally we have taken, and it is taken on 18th September 1949, the Constituent Assembly laid down the Constitution, and the Article 1 and a Part 1, there we can find this particular term where we proudly we can speak about our country India. It may say the name India or the name Bharat is originally we are talking about. We are not talking about the Hindustan or something like other names that is actually mentioned here by the different individuals and the different groups. You know, at the time when the varieties of people were visiting, they were confused because, you know, the India is a vast country. It's not a small country. It is very, very vast country. And in order to understand the country India, they have they really need the name of the different places. And together they will be giving the names. So that's why today we can find. Anyway, the Bharat, the term Bharat in fact actually derived from the our Indian legendary, that is King Bharat, the son of Dushyant and Shakuntala, okay, son of this two person. So and they are also the actually the sisters of the Pandavas and Kauravas. So that is also we have to understand about the our Indian history. So therefore the India is also actually referred as the Hindustan, and this particular term was actually derived from the Persian term, that is a Hindu, and the word Hindu actually Persian for Sindhu. You know, the Sindhu river, which is flowing,
जानो
दिस पर्टिकुलर रिवर इज ए फ्लोइंग एंड हियर यू कैन अंडरस्टैंड दैट हाउ दिस ए रिवर इनफैक्ट स्टार्ट्स फ्रॉम पाकिस्तान देन जम्मू एंड कश्मीर एंड अल्टीमेटली इट इज टचेज द आवर कंट्री इंडिया एंड फॉल्स इन द अरेबियन सी. So that's why this name of the rivers, taking the name of the rivers and then the name was actually nominated. So that is how we can find that different names of our country, India. Okay. So next we will be talking about that here the Persian historians, that is a person name is Minhaj Siraj. He also used this particular term Hindustan to describe which are the areas, you know, the Punjab, then Haryana and the lands between the Ganga and Yamuna. So this particular term actually, or the name of this landform only to refer, they use it Hindustan. Now different people have given the different names. Another term we are understanding, that is the Hindustan was really more of a reference to the context of the Sultanate that changed with the change in the political boundaries. So here the Mughals who came to India during the 14th century used the term Hindustan to refer to their territory in India. So that is so we can understand. So the name India has also been derived from the Sindhu that we have already earlier mentioned. So when the Persians conquered the Indian subcontinent and Greece in the 5th century BCE, that time Sindhu became the Hindus. Sindhu became the Hindus. See how this Hindu came. Sindhu became the Hindus and slowly evolved to Indos to mark the land of Hindus. So by the 17th century, what happened here? Indos transitioned into India. So that is how the name came to India. So different names of different names people nominated and different names came at this time. And so that is how we are speaking about. So therefore, we will now focus on the history during the medieval period, which was actually began in 700 CE to 1800 CE. So that is what we have to talk about today. So now let's see, after the arrival of the different groups of people in India, what are the major development has been taking place? So today in this class, I will be talking about. Now, when we talk about the major developments, so, you know, any new group of people arriving to different parts of the world, to any country. Let's see, we will talk about the country India. So here, suppose any new group will be arriving, either in the form of battle or in the form of any type of like a war. Suppose they arrived and they settled here. Certainly, they will not follow up what the country in fact was followed. They will bring their own culture, their own tradition, their own rituals, their own language, their own religion. So these are the all things will be practiced in the country where they are going to settle. So therefore, for example, we had the earlier this Pala ruler or maybe the Rajput and Pratiharas and all. But there this woke culture and this later medieval period the woke culture was much more different. So that's why we have to understand how this woke culture today we are seeing in India very much like a unique. Brightest people are actually living in India. And so today it is confusing in fact to live together, to associate together, to make the opinion together. It's not possible here. It's very much like a confusing and that people are not agree to each other. And as a result of, you know, the country is not at the point of development. So today, country India, even though we got the independence very early, in 1947 we got the independence, and yet our development is a very slow process because you see the different varieties of groups living, existing here are not actually mingling, and still people are, you know, not following the equality, and no one is actually taking care of each other, and you know, always the politicians are taking the advantage of the this particular groups to attack and to you know, very often the religious issues taking place in India. So this is one of the advantages for the politicians to survive over here. So in the name of the religion, you know, a lot of killing and cutting has been taken place all throughout the centuries, not only in India, but other part of the world even, this is the same. So, but you know, the people who have understood in a different parts of the world, those countries have been actually gone ahead, and now today they are very much ahead of us, around 20, 30 years they are ahead of us. So their development, their behavior, their cleanliness, their sanitizers, sanitation, many other areas, they are so much ahead. And morally, they are ahead of in technology. So here, what we are doing, here in India, what we are doing. Here in India is always a religious issue, is a very sensitive issue, which makes us to keep on be there only. And it is not allowing us to go ahead. And you know, at any moment, suppose development is we are talking about, you know, the religious comes first here. And people go more about the religion than the development. So that's why we are very poor, under development. Up to now, we are still in the third world country, we can say. So how far our country has been taken the lead of making the things happen. Yes, today we can talk about some development, but it is not too sufficient. Today, for example, engineer is after having completing his engineering, he may not get the job over here, and he has to look for the job of the other part of the world. And you know, education policy that we have got is very much outdated. Say only you can see the town and cities are some extent the innovative things are actually followed there, and a new a case study or practical things are actually done. But in most of the states are actually very, very poor condition in the schools and colleges and all. Hardly you will find that teachers, hardly you will find good teachers, qualified teachers. May say it's very difficult for the country India like that. So it is the major issue, in fact, has become better. Up to now, varieties of people living in India, up to now, they are not coming to the sense, but they are also engaged in the blind faith, so much of engaged in the religion, rather than focusing on the development and technology. So that is how we are. So anyway, so the medieval period of India actually witnessed a clear demarcation from the ancient period of the Indian history. And while the Aryans made India their home during the ancient period, and the Turks and the Mughals came to settle, and then they made this particular land their own land, and then they dominated. And then again, you will find that with the arrival of the different foreign visitors, a new culture developed. A new culture developed, and then that actually reflects, especially in the form of construction, architecture, and different buildings that we today presently we are visiting. So let us know about the examples. So examples are Taj Mahal, Red Fort, Agra Kila, Victoria Memorial, is it not? Then India Gate, many other monuments actually we find at that time. So these are the very much making the things actually happen, and then the different folk culture actually change the atmosphere of the people. And so students, today for example, when we talk about this development, it's very slow. In fact, it's very slow. You know, a lot of money was invested, but then you see the result is only this much. So you can understand. So today, for example, India could have become the very much shining city, and so much of a town and city, and even villages could have been so much advanced. But then today it's not did not become. You know, whoever the rulers came to India and invaded and settled over here and made their palaces for themselves only, for their only benefit only. But they did not focus on the road construction, the bridges construction and all, nothing of that sort we see. So therefore, whatever the things we have seen in Indian history are actually very much discouraging one. So anyway, so the medieval period began with the struggles between the Palas and Pratiharas and Rashtrakutas for the control of the power. And you can see that in South India also, the Cholas held the supreme power, and the Cholas were actually known to send trade missions to different countries. And also, during the medieval period, you know, two great empires emerged, that is Delhi Sultanate and then a Mughal Empire. So their influence, in fact, are visible right now I was talking about. So that is how we can see. And also we are talking about the contribution that they put forward. Yes, they have gone away, but their power was in decline, and then now it is in the Indian soil. So therefore, it is nothing much, but then a kind of like a small contribution that they did. You know, once you make the palace and all, you cannot carry and take it out to your country. So that is we can understand. So anyway, so the medieval period in India saw the rise of the towns and commercial and craft centers and all usually. So the society was actually also saw many changes in the social setup. So here we can find a social setup when we talk about, we saw the caste system actually started, and then the transition of tribal societies, and the Bhakti movement also began, Sufi movement and Sikhism also emerged in this period. So it means a varieties of like things happen, and then how this different groups of people in fact tried their level best to spread the different this religions and their tradition and cultures. It is not by genuinely or kindly, but then it is sometimes forcefully is done. Especially when we talk about Sultanate period or Mughal period, forcefully things have been done. So that's why today we see that a group of people, a large number of people also, visible, is not? So a large number of people are actually converted to one religion and all. So that is how we can understand. So anyway, so unlike the ancient period of the history, there are actually numerous literary sources for the medieval period. And in this next section, we will talk about the sources. You know, without source, the history is incomplete. And without source, you know, we can't understand the history. So this source actually a part of like a clues, part of evidence. Is it not? Part of the evidence and clues, these sources. Because this source will indicate about that period or that sort of like environment was existed at the time. So that is how actually we have to think of. Alright, so when we talk about the sources and all, so here especially the historians use the like literary sources, then archaeological sources, especially to construct the history. And again, you will find that there were more literary sources available for the medieval period in India. And there are certain limitations even attached to these literary sources, as many of the writings were actually accounts that revolved around the emperor's court and life. So very little or no reference can be found for the common people. So we will talk about only the especially in the history, we are talking about the only the people, especially those who are kings and rulers and empires and all. But then you will be not hearing about the common people's life here in the history, because they were just maybe in the hand of the rulers, they were just a puppet. Okay, so that is we can understand it. Alright, then again, during the medieval period, these literary texts were actually written by hand, not like today we have the printing press and all, and typing and a computer and all. But at that time, with the hand, any of the incidents were written, and then it was actually placed. And today we can see when those things are maybe available in a museum, in the library and all. Alright. Then again, these copies were actually also written in the handwritten, and sometimes while copying the original text, you know what happened? The writer would make certain additions or deletions text. So it may say whatever he has written in the originally, those original things while I will be copying or making, maybe I will be changing. You know, in order to show the goodness of my culture, in order to show my people's goodness, my people are good. So a historian will do the same. So they will just cut off the whatever the bad things are there. So they will not show the bad thing. So today, any of the kings that we see about, or any of the king or ruler, when we read about them, very little is about their bad things are mentioned. So that is how the history actually, kind of like a drawback, this one, kind of like a drawback. Okay? So how the history actually presenting to us today. So whatever we are studying today, whatever we are reading today, perhaps these are the not exactly original. Maybe something is connected with that. So different writers have written the history, and today those things are actually mentioned very little. So while reading the history, kindly you must take care that more about it you must also read from the other writers, so that you will understand about the broad history about the others. Okay? So anyway, so these are the few things that we are finding in order to construct the history. So also we find drawbacks from here, because the writers are actually deleting and changing the words and all. So these are the things we will be talking about. So in the next class, I will talk about the literary sources in detail, and I will make sure to know about the chronicles, biographies, then autobiographies, foreign accounts, all these areas I will talk about. Okay? So thank you, and take care all of you, and have a great day ahead.